Hello, welcome to this CESDA webinar concerning data on aspects of digital life. Can you hear us? I suppose yes. If not, check your volume and that your speaker headset is plugged in. Click on audio to change to listening via phone, because we are recording this webinar and we plan to put it on our website. The webinar is funded by CESDA ERIC, and it is implemented within the frame of CESDA training activities for 2019. It is hosted by SODANET, the Greek member of CESDA. And now, before going to the overview, I would like to present our guest speakers. Hello, Professor Nicholas Demetzis, professor at the University of Athens, director and president of the governing body of FECE. He will address how data from the World Internet Project supports research into the digital divide. Professor Demetzis is the representative of the World Internet Project in Greece, Cyprus, and his current academic and research interests include political sociology, cultural sociology, political communication, and sociology of emotion. Among his recent major works are Emotion in Politics, The Affect Dimension in Political Tension, London 2013, The Information Society, Governance and the Internet, Athens 2017, and his forthcoming major work, The Political Sociology of Emotions, Essays on Trauma and Resentment, Routledge in 2020. And our second guest speaker is Dr. Stamatis Poulakidakos. He works as laboratory teaching staff at the Department of Communication and Media Studies at the University of Athens. He is specialized in media monitoring, propaganda, and quantitative content analysis. Stamatis has authored the book Propaganda and Public Discourse, the presentation of the Memorandum of Understanding by the Greek media, Athens Da Vinci books, and he has co-edited Media Event, A Critical Contemporary Approach, Sir London, Palgrave, and Macmillan. So we turn to the overview. I will speak first. My name is Dimitra Kondili, and I am a member of SODANET and researchers at the Institute of Social Research at ECE, National Center for Social Research. I will introduce CESDA, the Consortium of European Social Science Data Archives. And important data sources on aspects of digital life and how to access this data. And then Professor Nicholas Demetzis will show you how to investigate the digital divide based on data from the World Internet Project. And then our third speaker, Stamatis Poulakidakos, will talk about the impact of social media during the national campaigns of the 2019 European elections. And then we have questions and answers. Please type questions into question box in the webinar control panel. Technologies, applications, and innovations in the digital economy and consequently digital life impact a broad range of economic societal areas. As according to World Bank data, in 2018, there are 3.4 billion internet users worldwide, which means over half the global population, whilst the percentage shrinks when we refer to the share of households with a computer at home worldwide. ICTs have also transformed the data landscape by creating the so-called data deluge. We will shortly highlight some key data sources as well as surveys that cast light on some of these aspects of digital life. Because of this accumulation and production, data sets can be found in many sites and be distributed by many data archives or repositories, etc. What is CESDA? The Consortium of European Social Science Data Archives has a great mission to enable research community to conduct high quality research in the social sciences by providing a full-scale sustainable research infrastructure, to develop standards and best practices, to promote training and knowledge with regard to social science data, and to render data fair, findable, accessible, interoperable. What we will try to do today is to locate this data. CESDA ERIC, because it's a European organization, is currently composed of 90 member countries and one observer. If you click when you are online, if you go to the CESDA website and click on the name of each country, you will have access to the repositories, to the service providers of CESDA. Greece is in the middle, and if you click in, then you have SODANET. We will start with one major source in Europe, Eurostat. As you know, it's the statistical office of the European Union, and you can find many data on the use of information and communication technologies for households, individuals, measurement of digital skills, etc. You can, when you navigate within Eurostat, you can see the glossary of the topic that you want to investigate, and then related topics and concepts, etc. If you want to find the data, users can find statistics by navigating through specific topics, as you saw in the previous slide. And for accessing Eurostat microdata, researchers can apply via their research organizations, though under the condition that these organizations are recognized as research entities. If you are an individual researcher, then you have to supply with a special permission and research proposal to Eurostat. National statistical offices in Europe provide data with these surveys. An example is the Hellenic Statistical Authority, which conducts from 2002 all surveys concerning the use of ICTs by household and individuals, and all of this data from the national statistical offices are provided and used within Eurostat for the benchmarking and the indicators of for information society. Access to the Elstat and to many other statistical national offices is granted upon request along with detailed research proposals. When we come to the international data sources, like OECD, in OECD databases, data can be browsed by topic or country. Users can find and share data that is browsed by topic or country as well. In addition to data, indicators and publications are also available to users. Here, for instance, if you search for ICTs, all surveys, data, publications and related documents are stored under the rubric Innovation and Technology, and some of them under the rubric of Society. Another very important international data source is the consortium of ICPSR. ICPSR is an inter-university consortium for political and social research. Provides leadership and training in data access, curation, and method of analysis for the social science research community. And access can be freely downloaded by general public for certain data sets, whilst some other data sets are available only to users at ICPSR member institutions. When you go through ICPSR, you will see the different types of conditions, though public files are accessed by the general public. You can see in the screen some data related to our topic. The Pew Research Center, it makes its data available to the public for secondary analysis after a period of time. You can see on the link how to get to Pew Research Center data as well relevant documentation. It was one of pioneer organizations involved in studying aspects of digital life for 30 years, with Pew Internet and American Life Project, started in 1999. The only condition is that users have to register at the beginning in Pew Research Center, and then, according to a contracts and agreements with data producers, some of this data can be accessed under a specific request. The international data, the World Bank is also an international data source. Data can be accessed directly, statistical data as well, and infographics and reports that can lead you to data as well. And then we will show you some important comparative social surveys, some of them as at European level and some of them at the international level. The European Social Survey, which is an ERIC as well as CESDA, is an academically driven cross-national survey that has been conducted across Europe since its establishment in 2001 and covers surveys for over 30 nations. Its aim is to measure and explain trends in attitudes, beliefs, and values across countries in Europe and its close neighbors. Since the first round in 2002 to the latest one, 2018 ESS9 round, there is information about using internet, World Wide Web, and email, whether at home or work, for personal use. For next round, ESS10, there will be a new module on digital social context in work and family life for the first time. Access to ESS data can be done via ESS website. For accessing ESS data, users should register to NSD, the Norwegian Social Science Data Service, which is a CESDA service provider as well. Another important comparative survey is the International Assessment of Adult Competences, PIAAC, which is an ongoing program of assessment measuring adults' proficiency in key information processing skills, literacy, numeracy, and problem solving in technology-rich environments. Data can be accessed through public use files, code books, background questionnaires and all materials needed to undertake your own research analysis of the PIAAC data, like the International Data Explorer, which is especially made for analyzing PIAAC data. You can see the screen in the OECD, because OECDs coordinate this huge international program, and you can see PIAAC data, documentation, tool for analysis, etc. Another European but international at the same time survey on, it's a public opinion survey, is Eurobarometer. You can we choose two slides, because you can see that you can access Eurobarometer either through the European portal or Guesses, which is another service provider of CESDA. All data for the Eurobarometer are hosted by Guesses, but you can find data concerning Eurobarometer at the ICPSR and some other databases. And finally, the CESDA data catalog, which contains the metadata of all data in the holdings of CESDA service providers. It's a one-stop shop service for data search and discovery, and enables effective access to European social science research data. Till now, there are data in six languages, and there is the CESDA thesaurus. You can find and access the data leaded to each service provider, and it's, you can navigate through this thesaurus of data thesaurus. And then we choose as the last, I choose as the last slide for my presentation, the World Internet Project, which is a major international collaborative project looking at the social, political, and economic impact of the internet and other new technologies. Users, if they want to have access to the data itself, the data file, users should contact countries members, though relevant materials and extensive detailed reports, etc., are stored within the World Internet Project. Concerning Greece, World Internet Project is, and Cyprus as well, World Internet Project is documented and can be found via SODANET. And now our first guest speaker, Professor Demirdjis. The floor is yours, Professor Demirdjis.
Hello, thank you very much. As Mrs. Convili already said, I'm going to speak about the digital divide using data from the World Internet Project. So, to start with, I would say that by the early 20s, when the internet studies and the sociology of the internet and the sociology of the information society has started to become a full-fledged area of research and teaching in the universities, at least around the Western world, the digital divide was one of the main issues to be discussed and researched in these disciplines and sub-disciplines. And not only it was not only an issue of sociological interest, but it was also an issue which preoccupied the concerns of those people who were who were engaged with the political economy of the internet. Therefore, the sociology of the internet and the political economy of the internet are two much related subfields whose main concern, among others, is the digital divide. So, what the digital divide? Actually, to be more precise, one should speak in plural rather than in the singular tense. It's more appropriate to speak about digital divide rather than the digital divide. But anyhow, let's start with the digital divide, which 15 years ago was understood as the percentage of those who could not have access to the internet, or even it was even understood as that percentage of people who didn't have access to a computer. Of course, that's not the case, at least for the Western part of the world. In the meantime, I want to I mean that in the meantime, as far as the internet was penetrating, more areas of the Western world, of the third world countries, and as much as the internet, the computer technology has been penetrating, people in the media studies and in the internet studies have started enlarging the meaning of the digital divide. Let me just show you a slide where the digital divide worldwide is depicted. The bar with the green line shows the world average, that is to say, the worldwide only 59, almost 59 percent of the population have access to the internet. But of course, if you break this percentage down to different areas of the world, you see that in North America, that the percentage goes almost sky high, almost 90%. Also, the same holds for Europe. Then comes Latin America and Australia, and then the Middle East, Asia, and Africa. The difference between Africa and North America is really colossal. If you see, it's 37, almost 37 to almost 90%. So the difference is more than apparent, and that difference, that digital divide between two continents, actually, does not only reflect a discrepancy in terms of internet access, but also this is an indirect index which says much about the socioeconomic gap between these two regions of the world. Yes, but if we move from the third world countries to the Western world, or to the to less developed countries, which in the sociology of are usually described as countries of the semi-periphery, there we are prepared to come to terms with an additional concept, which is the divide after access. That means that that in countries either in the center or in the periphery, or in the semi-periphery, where access is already achieved. The point is to see whether there are differences between different kinds of access. By this I mean that it is not enough anymore to have access, but what counts more is the quality of access. What counts more is the digital skills, the skills and capabilities, the competencies people have after their share access to the internet is secured. And then one can see that there are clear differences which actually mirror background differences and inequalities in terms of socioeconomic level, in terms of education, and so on. Before showing you additional slides, let me tell you that in the relevant literature, which refers to the countries of the semi-periphery, there has been a hypothesis that as soon as these countries are helped in terms of rapid ICT infrastructures infusion, then these countries are expected to perform a frog leap effect, so to say. So if you have a country which up to a certain point in time does not have good enough and good performance in terms of ICT penetration and ICT use, as soon as this country gets help, as that was the case with Greece in 1904, sorry, in 2004 with the Olympic Airways, where the country received a big amount of money for make investment and improvements in the ICT infrastructures, then these countries are expected to make a very big leap, a frog leap, so to say, so they may be able to bridge the gap between them and the more developed countries. Of course, this is not always the case. But even if that leap can be done, again the question of the gap after access is pertaining. So let me tell you a few words about the so-called so-called Digital Economy and Society Index, the well-known DESI. The Digital Economy and Society is an index which is composed by five different variables. First is connectivity, which measures the deployment of broadband infrastructure and its quality. Second is the human capital. The human capital variable measures the skills which are needed to take advantage for the possibilities offered by the digital society. As I was describing before, the issue is not just to have an infrastructure. The real issue is whether people, different age groups, and different classes. Different classes may have the necessary skills and competencies to make to get the most possible profit and advantage from this infrastructures. Then is the The other variable is the use of the of internet, which accounts for the for a variety of online activities performed by citizens. These activities usually have to do with purchasing online, with information on online information, with educational activities online, and so on. The fourth variable has to do with the integration of digital economy, sorry, digital economy, mostly assessed by e-commerce activities, and last but not least, is the digital public services. Actually, a lot has been done in Greece and in other countries. As far as the e-governance and e-government is concerned, and this variable measures assesses the extent to which citizens and public administration make use of online services in order to bypass traditional bureaucratic. Difficulties. This slide show you the ranking of the EU 28 countries based on DESI, on this index. The national mean score is almost 58%, 57%, whereas Greece is almost is second, but last, which means that Greece has to walk a very long road ahead in order to bridge the gap between other European countries, between Scandinavian countries and other countries in the European Union. Now I'm gonna move fast, rather fast, to as far as the Web Internet project is concerned. Personally, I am the representative of the Internet project both in Cyprus and in Greece. In Cyprus, we started making research about the penetration and the uses and the impact of the Internet as soon as 2008, and we implemented five different rounds. In Greece, we started on 2015, and we have completed three rounds. So, as far as the digital concern, the digital divide is concerned, one can very easily see from various slides that there are different divides as for, with regards to the place of residence, the type of area. In the case of Cyprus, this is the case both for the Greek Cypriots and the Turkish Cypriots, because we were lucky enough, at least for the last three rounds, 2012, 14, and 16, to include the Turkish Cypriot community as well. So you can see, for instance, that there is a certain divide between different areas of residence, but it is the age which makes for a very very strong and very strong digital divide. You see that in all rounds, the difference is monotonous. The more people get older, the less they make use of the internet. The same holds true, of course, with the educational level and with income. Although the difference between income and education and age is not that important. Regarding gender, there is a gender divide, which with the time being seems to pertain. For instance, in 2016, as far as the Greek Cypriots are concerned, there is a difference of almost 6% difference between male and female internet users, but the difference is almost 10% as far as the Turkish Cypriot community is concerned. Moving to Greece now. In Greece, according to our own measurement, there is an increase in the internet use between 2015 and 2017, and in 2015 it was almost 59%. We found that 59% of the population were using the internet, whereas this percentage got up to 71%. So promising, so to say, promising funding. And as far as the age divide is concerned, again we see that the more younger the people are, the more they use the internet. This is self-evident, but this is not self-evident, for instance, if we compare Greece with Canada, for instance, or with Japan, or with Sweden or Denmark. The divide holds with education. The more educated people are, the more they use the internet. This is clearly the case with Greece. What did we find here? We have the more people are in the labor market, the more are expected to use the internet in order to find some job or something. I'm gonna skip this, again the same holds with income, and with this I'm gonna finalize my presentation because we don't have much time, I think. And thank you very much for your attention. I hope that was of help. And it was something of informative value.
Stamatis, the floor is yours.
So now I assume that you can hear me. Thank you for the invitation to attend and talk to this webinar on the influence, let's say, of digital technologies and the new media on various interesting social phenomena. What am I going to talk about today is my participation as a researcher as part of the Greek research team on the project Platform Europe, which actually produced an open archive, which I'm going to show you in a while. Actually, I'm going to introduce you to the archive and the data that it includes. The Project Platform Europe, its, let's say, main rationale behind it, as a brief introduction, is an international research project that is led actually by Roma Tre University in Italy. And it's co-funded in its last version in 2019 by the European Parliament. I'm talking about this last version because the first time that we ran a similar research on the pre-electoral material of the European elections was back in 2014, the elections of 2014, where we actually conducted research on TV spots, TV commercials, and print ads, print political ads of the political parties, of the major political parties all over Europe for all the 28, up to now at least, countries that form the European Union. So we, in a sense, repeated this effort with a kind of enhanced codebook. I'm going to show a bit the codebook as well later on. And with the inclusion of social media material as well for the current elections, for the 2019 election. So the general aims of the project were mainly to promote the dissemination and knowledge of the European election campaign first, and the raise awareness about the European election campaign, to improve the transnational circulation of the electoral materials that were produced in the different nations, in the different respective nations of the EU and their major political parties, to allow the European citizens to access and compare the different national European campaigns and political proposals, of course, to improve the comparative study and knowledge of European political communication, political cultures, and why not political history as well. So in that sense, we established what we called Platform Europe, a consortium of different universities and research centers from all 28 European EU countries. We defined, after the establishment of the network, the initial establishment of the network, we defined the code books for the analysis, the different code books that were actually tailor-made to meet the specific characteristics of the TV ads on one hand, the press ads on the other, and the social media material that we were going to analyze. We seek to develop an online web platform for the analysis and for uploading all the materials, which is open access to everyone. I'm going to show it, as I told you before, afterwards. In research terms, we seek to monitor, we seek to collect, monitor and analyze the European electoral campaigns in all 28 member states, and to create a database of electoral materials produced for the European election campaigns in each member state. We developed a digital platform that contained those collected materials. We actually ran, that was a side action, let's say, of the project, of the research project. We ran in each country during the pre-electoral period of the 2019 elections 28 respectively different national workshops, that in each one of them there was a kind of public debate on the way that the electoral material is being disseminated and the European and the election campaign is being actually conducted in its country. And of course, we have already released several reports on the European electoral campaign process and development at both national and transnational level. I have to say, regarding the elaboration of the data, that we are in a currently at the rather initial stages of the elaboration of the data, of the quantitative elaboration of the data mostly, which is undergoing, currently undergoing, and will be completed or concluded hopefully during 2020, and we'll end up in the publication maybe of an edited volume that will have to do with the electoral period, or maybe even be comparative between the two last pre-electoral periods that we actually scrutinized in 2014 and 2019. Regarding the procedure, in order to get this thing started, we had initially a two-day kickoff meeting that was held in Rome in the beginning of April, in early April. In which kickoff meeting we were officially presented with the back office platform and the EMC website for the 28 national research units. We had in one day training session on the analysis codebooks and the monitoring and use of the platform. The analysis, I have to say, in vague terms, that actually included several verbal characteristics of the campaign content. For example, whether the electoral material appeared mostly at the national or European dimension, which policy issue or issues that the analyzed content was focusing on, whether there was evident any kind of negativity or humor or irony. We also analyzed several issues that had to do with visual characteristics of the pre-electoral material, such as the facial expressions, the dress code that was adopted or depicted in terms of the politicians, iconographic styles, and to what extent, for example, political symbols were visible in the any kind of pre-electoral material. So we began actually the activity on the top of this slide. I'm giving you the exact link for the open archive that we have, and I'm going to take you in a while there to see it for yourself, make a bit of a sightseeing. So it began its activity at the beginning of the electoral campaign on late April, actually, and during the 4 weeks, of course, was on and active during the 4 weeks of the pre-electoral period, leading up to the vote. And of course, in that sense, we allowed thousands of visitors to watch the evolution of the electoral campaigns in all the 28 nations and to compare their similarities and differences, even if there is, you know, the barrier and the restriction of the different languages. But as far as we understand, several things that might be extra linguistic that could give us a vague, let's say, estimation about the similarities and differences of the pre-electoral campaigns in the different countries. There was, in order for this task to be accomplished, there was a multidisciplinary network of universities established with scholars and researchers that are active in the study of the European election campaigns, European issues, and political communication. We've got a quite extensive archive and database that up to now, maybe it's even unmatched in terms of the wealth of data it provides for political regarding political communication and political campaigns in the European elections. As I told you before, we had this 28 university workshops on the campaigns that were attended by more than 1,000 students and were streamed to the social network accounts of the EMC of the project. We made use of the wide use of the social media, of course, to disseminate, to promote our research effort. And an initial final conference, to be honest, was conducted in Brussels in early July 2019. Of course, apart from those instances, there's a wide dissemination in the public sphere of relevant quasi-academic articles and presentations at the national and international level. Of course, there are reviews and comments in national newspapers and television stations, and more, of course, as I told you before, articles and analysis will be published during 2019 and beyond. So how did this work in technological terms? A crawler that was managed by a small AI component, artificial intelligence component, collected the Facebook content posted and monitored by monitored accounts. Actually, in terms of Facebook, in terms of collecting the social media data, we chose Facebook to be our social medium that would participate in our research, and we managed to monitor through this automatic way, actually, and collect material from the seven accounts of the major political parties of each country. This was the limit. We could monitor up to seven parties from each country. So the monitoring of those accounts was made in order to make them available to the various European research teams. this crawler worked on a 4 weeks time span. It gathered more than 30,000 elements or research units, actually posts from social media, and provided at the same time automated updated metrics on which those things were referring to and so on, such as the engagement that was generated by the political subjects, the most relevant topics of the online political agenda, and several other basic parameters. The web intelligence platform supplied each national research unit with a reserved area in the back office, as you will see later on, where we as national research groups were able to monitor and file all the contents that were gathered during the election campaign. Sorry about that. We co-created in a way specific code books in order to file the social media contents automatically in the online platform, and of course to comment upon and scrutinize upon the election materials that we collected in a non-automatic way, in a manual way, by the research teams. For example, all the Facebook posts that we actually conducted our research upon were, as I told you before, automatically input into the back office of the research by the crawler machine. But on the other hand, we had to upload any kind of posters, press ads that we could find, or TV ads that we could find either online or offline. So we had to upload those this kind of content. So in total, we made use of 48 variables for the content analysis in order to analyze visual and verbal dimensions and to identify several geopolitical data that would be interesting for our analysis. This project ran entirely online, and the uploading of the codebooks to the web and the highly automated monitoring process were activated through the platform reduced as much as possible the error margin. And besides this, running the project online allowed real-time updates of the content archive and the European Elections Monitoring Center website. So as this thing was ongoing during May, mostly since April 28th, as far as I remember, to May 30th, to May 29th, which was the last, as far as I remember, date of the elections in several member countries. This was all online. It was constantly running. It was updated in real time. So as for the people that logged in, would be able to see the newest versions of the contemporary reports or of the data that we uploaded and so on. This is a brief table of the workshops that were conducted in all different countries and their titles and the dates. Then that's the amount of data in quantitative terms that we gathered by all different respective countries. The total comments that were uploaded in the platform, the total analysis units, either in the form of social media posts, of Facebook posts to be precise, of TV ads, or of press ads, or any other poster material, it's 12,556. The vast majority, as one can understand, of this material is related to the social media content. More than 11,000 of our code units are the Facebook posts that we've gathered from the different parties and the different countries. More than 1,000 are the posters and press ads that we gathered, and approximately 500, less than 500, are the commercials, the TV spots that were uploaded in the platform in order to be analyzed with the use of our code books. As far as you can see, there is a drop down on the lower side of this slide. There are the bars indicating the analogy, the proportion, and the numbers of the material that was gathered in the different areas of Europe. We can actually have made a kind of discrimination of the European countries in four geopolitical areas: Western Europe, which contained Austria, Belgium, France, Germany, Luxembourg, and Netherlands, Eastern Europe, Bulgaria, Czech Republic, Hungary, Poland, Romania, and Slovakia, Northern Europe, which included Denmark, Estonia, Finland, Ireland, Latvia, Lithuania, Sweden, and United Kingdom, and Southern Europe, which included Croatia, Cyprus, Greece, Italy, Malta, Portugal, Slovenia, and Spain. As far as you can see, Southern Europe in quantitative terms dominates, actually accounts for an approximately 40% of the total material that was gathered for the scopes of the current research. Actually, now I'm going to take you to the first. That's the open access archive that we have, our the homepage of our open access archive. The web address is www.electionsmonitoringcenter.eu, and it's open access. As I told you before, anyone can log in, and in the beginning, in the web, in the first page, the homepage, you're going to find, among others, an interactive map of the European countries that participated in the research and their proportion, their contribution in total numbers to the materials that were gathered, for example, to the data units that were gathered. For example, in Portugal, we have 1,271 research units that, if I press on it, as it's an interactive map, will show me in a, hopefully quickly, we'll get some issue sometimes in loading, but still should be quite easy to operate. Let's try another country. Don't know what happened. I just tested before. Yeah, here we are. Let's, for example, try Greece. Yeah, okay. That's weird because usually things in Greece do not run that quickly, but the online world is something totally different, I assume. Anyway, so as you can see, on whichever country you click on, you can get some basic data on the specific country first, and you on the top of the page you get a an overview of the total material collected. Of course, if you scroll down, you can see some of the material that were uploaded. And of course, you can actually use specific filters in order to filter the materials that were uploaded, that are openly uploaded here, in terms of content, whether it's a poster, a commercial, a social media, or a press advert. Which kind of party, which party actually, these are the national parties of Greece that were scrutinized and run for the European elections, or even regarding to the topics. We have made a kind of basic discrimination between, let's say, basic topic categories that would be interesting to conduct the research on. This, of course, can be made for each different country or throughout Europe. We have here the on the collective map of Europe in the first page, we've got the party families, as at least they were up to the 2019 European elections. They're undergoing several transformations now. So you can choose party families here, or the topics again. We have here the categorization. And on the bottom of the page, if you choose something of those, for example, the European Democratic Party, you will see the number of electoral material that is being uploaded by this party, by the parties that are affiliated to the European party family. Socialists as well, you can see the number changing here, and so on. On the bottom of the main page, you can find the already published first report, which is the general report that was published in mid-July. And I'm gonna show you maybe if we can have some time, some parts of it. And of course, some contemporary reports, some reports that were actually published during the research period. So apart from that, I'm taking you now to the back office. This was a basic overview of the open access database that we have here. For everyone to see. I must note here that for each materials that were uploaded, in the this open access database, we've got, as we can see, as you can see, some brief translation in English as well, so as to kind of try to overcome a bit the language barrier in the different languages in the EU. So now I have taken you back to our back office where we actually conducted the research. You can see some uploaded material here. There's a print advertisement from the it was the only print advertisement that we actually uploaded here in Greece. The whole campaign was really digital or audiovisual in the latest European elections. As I told you before, apart from the social media material that was actually uploaded automatically by the web crawler that we had, we actually uploaded ourselves the print and the TV commercials. And to that end, after we had uploaded, or while uploading the content at the same time, we, by pressing this button here that says codebook, we actually opened the codebook with the different variables that we actually had to fill in order to categorize in different aspects the material that we were actually scrutinizing. So we had a first, to begin with, an explicative document title, the party or coalition name, the European party family, if the party was affiliated to a certain European family, the link, for example, the vast majority of the audiovisual material could be found on the respective YouTube accounts of the party. So the only thing that we had to actually do after locating the material was to just copy paste the link in here, and the platform would have the access, would link, let's say the platform would be linked with the specific content in the YouTube account. This specific content, for example, this specific commercial that I opened here is a commercial of DiEM25 Greece, in which Yanis Varoufakis seeks to urge people to go and vote. There were several commercials of that rationale as well. By pressing here next, I'm moving on to the next variables that were actually used to scrutinize the content. If there is a their specific, let's say, typology, the main genre of political communication or video, if there is a whether there is a negative attack, or if there is a kind of deployment of humor, satire, irony, parody, and so on.
Tamatis,
so I should put a,
you
put an
should
end to that.
Run
right.
A bit, because time is running, and
no, I'm pretty flexible. I can actually stop here right now, but I just try to make an overview, a brief, really brief overview of how we worked on that, given that we have only initial up to now initial quantitative data, and we further, you know, we are undergoing elaborating those things. So, okay, I'll put an end on that. I put an end on my presentation, and of course, I'm opening the floor to questions. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Stamatis. And there are some questions. There is one question for Professor Demergis. You mentioned that there is a lot of work in relation to digital divide that will need to be done in Greece. How can government use data from WIP, and what is being done in Greece in regards to promoting internet in older population? And another question, Stamatis, it's for you. How do you deal with copyright issues, posters, etc., things that are uploaded? And did you get this form, these from political parties themselves, or anyone can upload materials?
So, Professor Demergis,
Professor Demergis.
Okay.
Thank you for the question.
Very well.
It is not accidental that recently a new Ministry of Digital Policy has been launched in Greece. And whose main objective is to digitalize public administration and mitigate the digital divides in various aspects. Of course, the government, the central government, and the local government and the peripheries may make use of the data produced by the World Internet Project, as well as the relevant data produced by the and provided by the European Commission, the Eurostat. A pertinent issue in Greece is that most of the time Greek governments do not take seriously into account scientific data and research results in order to implement documented public policies. That has been more or less the case with ICT public policies in Greece, although this ministry is more determined to take into account big data and information about these issues in order to shape and implement policies for bridging the gap and also bringing older age cohorts into the information society context. In the past there have been a number of attempts to promote internet access to the older population, and that those initiatives were undertaken both by the private sector and by local authorities. This is a crucial issue, actually, because in Greece, as well as in other countries of the semi-periphery, older people do not use very often the internet, and as I showed in my slides, AIDS makes up for a very serious digital divide, and that digital divide comes to that digital divide adapts to other social discrimination and social inequalities. Adapts to what it's called multiple discriminations. Imagine someone who is unemployed, someone who is of another ethnicity. Imagine someone who is not very much educated and at the same time does not have internet access. This is a kind of multiple discrimination, especially if you adapt to this, this person might not have access to public health services and to educational services, which may be get deteriorized because of his or her lack of internet access. So it's actually crucial to tackle with this discriminations and internet access and upgrading digital skills makes for this mitigating of discriminations and social inequalities. Of course, it has to become clear that even if upgrading of digital skills. Even if a country like Greece upgrades to the DESI index, that does not immediately make for an advancement of this country. And that social inequalities in toto are going to be limited, not to say eliminated. A lot remains to be done, and therefore we have to work a very long way ahead.
Tamatis, there is a first question that I have already told you, but there is two others. Ones for technical, I think, as well. The
All
first
right.
on copyrights, and the second one. This is a very interesting project. I'm very curious to know what are the components of your data management plan. Where do you plan to archive this data, and what type of support would you need? These are staff. This is staff from the archives who are very interested, apparently, to the project. And the other one, how a researcher that is not a collaborator of the election monitoring project access the full content that was collected and downloaded.
All right. So, first things first, I'm going to start with the intellectual property rights. We had that issue. That's why I'm having the page open here in my screen with Germany. Actually, we had the issue that in different countries, there were different legal, there are different legal frameworks in terms of intellectual property rights. So we had to deal with them in a different way. For example, in Greece, we don't have this problem that much because any published material, pre-electoral material by the parties is considered to be a public material. So anyone can download it and have access, freely access it, and so on. So we didn't have to get any kind of written permission on behalf of the parties in order to download it and incorporate it for research, of course, reasons, research and educational reasons to the to our archives, to our open archives. But we had this issue in Germany. That's why, for example, here that I'm having this page open, we have the note that several electoral images, electoral materials, part of the electoral materials from German political parties are momentarily not available for copyright reasons, because the German team, research team, should have or will have at some point all the adequate licenses, all the adequate permissions, so as to have this material properly uploaded in the archive. This has to do with the legislations in the respective countries. So in terms of the technical, the second question, I'm going to the second question now. In terms of the technical infrastructure, this was supported by a by an enterprise in Rome, an Italian enterprise, Capusons, if I remember correctly, that they were responsible for the creation of the database and for providing the server, I think, for the hosting of the whole project and the open archive and the creation of the back office as well in order to run the research. I can't be too much detailed on that. I can't talk too much in too much detail for that because I'm just I was just head of the national Greek research team, and the let's say major organizational issues were handled by the heads of the research project. On one behalf was Eduardo Novelli from Roma Tre in Rome. You can actually, if you want, email him as well, contact him to get a more maybe specific in technical terms answer. Or Bengt Johansson from Sweden. These were the two that were the coordinators, let's say, of the whole project and could have a more detailed view of those, you know, the questions, and could provide more detailed information from the info that I could give you right now. And in terms for the access of non-affiliated research or members, one could, for example, in the web page here, we have a special part of the menu is refers to the research teams. So anyone could actually contact the respective national research teams. These are the names and the emails are openly here offered to anyone, so as to talk on any kind of access on the material that has been gathered for the scopes of the current research, even though the material from the respective countries, I am noting, underlining that one once again, is already uploaded in the web page. But still, if somebody wants, anything more specific, you can contact the research team, the research teams directly, the respective research teams directly for each country, and ask them whatever you might be interested in asking them. So that's all from me.
Thank you, Stamatis. I don't see any other question. The time has run very quickly, so we have to keep to leave you. Thank you very much for listening. If you have any further questions, then send to the webinar address or to Professor Demergis or Stamatis or me for any further explanation. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
This video is produced by the Consortium of European Social Science Data Archives. For more information on CESDA, please visit www.cesda.eu.